You're listening to the For Frequency Sake Network. What's a frequency can at the shop in some dream?
For Frequency's Sake is brought to you by Durham Remodeling, serving the Quad City area's remodeling and repair needs since 1973. Clint's Draft House, grab a bite and a pint on 7th Street in Moline. Low Pies, New York-style pizza served by the slice or pie, Davenport. Lifted Energy, energy drinks, coffee, donuts, and more, hashtag get lifted. Atomic Sports Cards and Collectibles, sports cards and memorabilia, vintage clothing, hats, pennants, and more. Yard Barbers, providing the Quad City area with all their yard care needs. Go yard with Yard Barbers. A Cut Above, offering quality custom woodwork designed specifically around our customers. Hello and welcome to another exciting edition of the Cards Subject to Change podcast, the podcast by the fan for the fan. I'm your host, never wrong, Nick Bull. Joining me as always is my tag team partner, our tag team champ of the podcasting network, the Wizard CZ. Wiz, how you doing tonight?
I'm doing pretty good, and I gotta give a shout out. We had Joe Winkle and Nick Brinks over on the Educated Ignorance podcast saying that they were the tag team champions of For Frequency's Sake. No way, sirs. You want to challenge us? You gotta go through us to get those tag titles.
I totally agree. And if you want them there, we'll put them up in a ladder match. That's the only way we'll do it, right?
Absolutely.
You're climbing the ladder, CZ. I got bad knees.
Well, we'll see how that goes.
We're inching our way to episode 100. That's next week. But first, we've got the fellas from Absolute Pro Wrestling joining us for episode 99. The pros of Absolute Pro, if you will. The pros of Absolute Pro, Jason Prentice, who has one of the most impressive wrestling rooms I've ever seen. Thank you for joining us. And Brandon the Shank Eubanks. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I just got to preface this. Brandon may be a little preoccupied. He's got 2010 going on in the background. So he may be a little preoccupied with our show being recorded. So I had to bust you out. I had to bust you out on it.
God, I told you to hide that stuff, man. I don't want people to know I watch crap wrestling and you're out here selling me out two minutes into it.
Now listen, we all are guilty.
What we know is, by the way, Absolute tag champ, understand about the tag biz, but brother, real quick, he's going to turn on you. I've already seen this done once. He sold me out in 2 minutes. The moment that he gets put on, he wants you to hit the – he said, you go to the top of the ladder. Oh, wonder why.
Big man climbing the ladder. We're gonna see somebody fall. That's
so, I love it. Yes, I am watching the pay-per-view. Oh, Tanny just put the stripes on. Watch out. Got to get him, Tanny.
He's got skinny.
Oh, Teddy didn't. Oh, man. I'm not spoiling it for nobody else. Go watch on the Peacock right now, 2010, Fatal 4-Way.
No. Don't watch it right now. Wait till we're done.
No, wait. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, right. Wait till it's done.
Watch on the
I'm just top. Saying. Skinny Drew McIntyre, PhD English, Kofi Kingston, match number one, Theodore Long. Little Nate, it should be the main event. I love how they start hot.
Brandon, you are in the right place if you have an affinity for watching bad wrestling. One of my all-time favorite shows is Super Clash 3, the AWA old show where the main event, one of the main events is like Von Erich and Lawler, and Von Erich is so messed up. He blades his bicep as he takes it off. And get a chance to watch it. It's a classic show and it's one of my favorites. But if you like bad wrestling, you're in the right.
Oh, I that's why I only watch myself.
Right. Nick knows this all too well. My guilty pleasure is always 1996 uncensored, the battle to end Hulkamania, the three-tiered cage, where Hulk and Macho Man go up against eight other guys and come out smelling like roses.
See, why don't we book like that, Prentice? Come on. Except for, so our budget's not that big. So hear me out. Hear me out. We get a dog kennel, right? Yep. One of them outdoor ones. That's stage number one. Okay. Yep. Stage number two. I don't know, but we'll figure it out. All right.
We'll figure it out.
But stage one, crazy.
Bull roll all the way around the ring.
Jason, Brandon, I'm going to ask you guys the same question I ask every one of our other guests. And it doesn't matter to me who answers first, but why professional wrestling? What got you hooked and why are you a fan?
I'll let you go first.
Yeah. So I really got in at a very young age. I mean, my earliest memory is just being at my grandmother's watching old VHS tapes because my mom worked at a video store when I was very young, and I would just get all these copies of just WCW pay-per-views and WWE pay-per-views, and I was just hooked, you know, and I just kept watching from a very, very young age all the way up until I graduated high school. And I just knew I wanted to get into the business at some point. I didn't know how much of a history my family had in the business either, which was really cool to find out after the point, you know, after all that. But I just, at a really young age, my mom was into it, my grandmother was into it, and it that kind of helped kind of stabilize my love for pro wrestling because other people around me were also fans of it. They didn't like it wasn't shameful, you know, because there's people who kind of look at pro wrestling as a dirty little thing, like, that's a sideshow, whatever. But I had people that I was close to that were like, no, this is really cool. We like it. We enjoy it. We enjoy watching it. And I think that really, like I said, from a young age, helped me kind of carry it through my whole life.
Was there a go-to VHS that sticks out in your mind? Was there
exactly what I was going to say?
What was the one that you would watch over and over again?
So on one VHS tape, my mom got this copy of a tape from a friend, and I messed up at my grandma's house. My grandma used to babysit me and my cousins, and on one VHS tape, it was The Breakfast Club, The Legend of Billie Jean, and WrestleMania 10, all on one VHS.
Oh, okay.
So, like, from the time I go to my grandmother's house to the time my mom's off work, I got my whole day set, basically, with these three things. I messed up, though, during Bret and Owen. I accidentally hit record. And so I missed like the first, at least I'd say 45 minutes of Mania 10 on that VHS. I miss it. It's like local access television. Here's what's coming up in your for 45 minutes. And then we get to Man on the Mission coming out with Oscar doing this. And I'm like, oh my God. So like I actually would make my mom rent WrestleMania 10. Just so I could watch it in its entirety as a kid. Because I'm like, oh, I can't watch it now on this VHS. I mean, I can, but I got to fast forward. You know, the kids don't know the difficulty nowadays of fast forward in the 90s and the early 2000s as it is now. But yeah,
all VHS tapes, by the way, not just WrestleMania.
Yes. No. Yeah, I had to be kind and move forward real quick here.
You had to remember what time it was.
Absolutely.
I guess now when I go back and watch WrestleMania 10, I'll cringe during Bret and Owen knowing that you recorded over it, but I'll laugh when Men on a Mission come out.
Absolutely. I do. I don't remember. Like, I'm like, man, that match was really quick. Because, like, Men on a Mission are there and then they're gone. They're just, boom. It's just in, out. And I'm like, they didn't win the tag belts. And I get this full VHS tape. I'm like, God, there's a lot of information I didn't know.
Speaking of information I didn't know, it's 2010 and Gail Kim is signed.
Brandon, what got you hooked on pro wrestling? Why? What got you hooked as a fan, and why are you still immersed in pro wrestling?
Right here, two reasons. Nobody believes me that I was a Hardy Boy fan before they were even the fucking Hardy Boys on TV. Excuse my French. But I remember. So my earliest memories is like 96, but it's very spotty. I'm, by the way, born in 93. So my memory goes back. Yeah, right there. Yeah. Hi, Jeff Hardy. I'm a huge Jeff Hardy mark. I got all my autographs are up there. But I mean, got them. But so like, I didn't have friends growing up. I got picked on by my little brother. I was that kid. I was a fat kid. And it's the 90s, dude. We all know what's the hottest ticket. What's beating Monday Night Football? Monday Night Raw.
Right.
So, yeah, and it's Austin. So, like, you know, I'm also a huge Austin mark. By the way, if I ever meet Kevin Owens, I'm going to bawl, just hysterically cry in his arms and thank him for wrestling. Because I kicked everybody out of my house for my WrestleMania party, and I sat in silence and cried the happiest quiet tears of my life. I just sat there like quiet like this and just kept rolling down my face with just hundreds of tears. It was crazy. It was so sad. I loved it.
Now, Shank, you're a good-sized dude. So the visual of Kevin Owens holding you
would be beautiful because we're about the same size. I might even be a little bigger than him. I call him Dad. You know, Papa. He's like, what's wrong? Why? And he'd be like, yeah. It was freaking awesome, wasn't it? I'm that dude. I love it so much. But yeah, no. So back to where my ADD left off. So, like, I love the Hardy Boys, dude. And the thing about, like, Jeff Hardy specifically was, like I said, I had no friends. And the way I turned out as an adult was clearly not how I wanted to turn out as a kid. As a kid, I was going to be like 145 pounds. I was going to have all my eyebrows pierced, both my lips pierced, all these tattoos. And I turned out white trash as all could be. yeah, completely opposite. Don't get me wrong. I still listen to emo music. It's my favorite. Like, I look way different. But Waylon Jennings is what I look like. I listen to when it's really like, I love Taylor Swift too sometimes, you know, not all the time, but sometimes. But so that's like I said, so like kids who didn't have friends in the 90s, that's what it was. And it wasn't nothing when you seen somebody wearing an NWO shirt and you did one of these, it was just a common courtesy to tap too sweet me broski, no matter what. Yep. So that's kind of like the common ground of wrestling. You know, and then how I got to wrestling is way different than what happened. I started cage fighting at 15. I lied about my age, showed up to a fight and started cage fighting. And so
keep going with this story. I like this.
Oh God. I still got my championship belt from when I was 17 back in my other room too. It's my baby. But, so I cage fought for a while. And then, until about 25, I was kind of spotty about 23, 24, 25. I kind of got spotty, you know, did the dumb, got into some drugs, kind of got fat. Like I was a 205 pound champ and I'm on a diet now and I've lost 25 pounds now. Thanks, Mike Vitti. I'm 263 nice. Now. And so that lets you know, like that Christmas time I was 285. So
good for just you.
Coming down. I fluctuate pretty well, but no. So I was a 205 champ, man. And so, you know, and I won my championship at 17. I beat grown men as a teenager, which was kind of crazy and made my head just huge. And so, you know, I rolled with that for a while. Then I got fat because, like I said, I got on drugs. I started, you know, real good drugs too. Not just the ones everybody else likes. But so then I get off that. I get fat. And then I remember this yellow chair I had, and I'm scrolling through Facebook, and I just got done crying in my bathroom about how fat, 'cause I'm 325 pounds, and I'm gonna blow my head off at this point. I'm so tired of my life. I'm gonna kill myself. So I sat down and I'm sitting down, and I have money. I'm making a lot of money at this point. I'm scrolling through Facebook, and all I see is this wrestling school, and it said one spot left. And I just clicked it. I sent a message. Hey, do you guys got one spot? How much is it? I'm just, you never know. And it was $750. I had $800 in my account. I said, dude, when's school start? They said Saturday. That was Thursday. I didn't even take a, they usually, they're like, you can come in, take a bump, come check it. Nah, they're like, give me your money. Let's go. So I show up, man, and that's it. It's day one. I end up meeting our commentator, Badger Calhoun. God bless that guy. He is the biggest tool. By the way, I wish people would could put headphones in and listen to our commentary instead of just listening to the ring bounce around, because you would get way more out of listening to them. Tim and Top Shelf Tom talk, man. Those guys are amazing. Love them to death. That's pretty much how I got into wrestling, man. That's it. And then I just took a step in, and it gets a little crazier past that, because actually when you step into wrestling, you think it's all peachy cream and hugging and high fives. And when you find out the real harsh truth, man, your first year has got to be the hardest year of your life. More guys quit in their first 3 months than they do ever anything. And just get through that first year has got to be the hardest thing ever. I wasn't getting booked. My partner was getting booked and I wasn't. I was getting sad and emotional. And I'm like, what am I doing wrong? Because I came from MMA where I was the main event, because I was it was weird to see a 17-year-old kid beat people up. So I was super popular, super over in wrestling world. I was John Cena over as a kid, you know, so then I come to wrestling, I don't know, 8 years later, and it's nothing. It's not even like that. Doesn't matter how good you could beat somebody up, dude. It's has nothing to do with that. And so it took me a while, man. It took me a while to get my feet going and finally find out where I'm at. Turning face was probably the best thing I ever did. Holy crap. I level change.
So I love how you talked about Patrick Calhoun and your commentary team for Absolute Pro. I want to ask, because when I was at the show in Waterloo a couple months ago, I did get a chance to talk with I'm blanking on his name, the other commentator, and I didn't meet Badger.
Tom.
It was so loud, though, at the end of the show, everybody mulling out of there. I didn't get a good listen. Where can people watch Absolute Pro and hear that great commentary that you were talking about?
So we have the Prentice Wrestling Network. The Prentice Wrestling Network was created originally as USA Championship Wrestling, which we'll talk about, I'm sure, throughout this. Sure. My uncle used to have that promotion. I set up the YouTube because my uncle had no idea what YouTube was. He wanted to find a way to get his wrestling shows onto social media. I said, it's easy. You just do this. Okay, you're doing it. Okay, great. Send me the stuff. I'll take care of the rest. And so we just had this platform where we have over 3,000 subscribers who, once my uncle passed, we're like, we need some content, and this isn't happening. And once we started picking up our stuff, we started throwing all the content there and a few other promotions as well. And so if people are looking to watch the most recent anything that we're doing, they can go to the Prentice Wrestling Network on YouTube. And we have plenty of stuff from last year. We're gearing up for a really big 2024, because we're going to debut a TV-centric, TV episodic show with USA Wrestling for Absolute Pro Wrestling. And we're really excited about that. That's going to start with our first Waterloo show this year. We're going to work on a couple things over the next couple of months to kind of get our footing on it and what we like, what we don't like. And, we're really excited about it.
You also go check out.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I said you could also go check out. A lot of our stuff's on there. Not every show's on there, but don't mean to gloat real quick, but 2023 Match of the Year is on there this year. Let's go. I just want to throw that in there real quick.
Yeah, first
according to Tag Team Photography, by the way.
Shout out Clint Dye. Yeah, first TLC
good,
match.
Good friend of the podcast. Produced.
Yeah. Good brother right there.
Jason, a little bit. You said you had some family ties to the wrestling business growing up, to where you constantly had, it wasn't a dirty thing, or it wasn't, a dirty secret to be a wrestling fan. You had support system built around you. You said you had family involved in the wrestling business. Touch on that briefly. What did your family members do? And talk about this network a little bit more, this Prentice Wrestling Network and the stuff that's going to be found on there.
So my uncle, Bert Prentice, I didn't know anything about the Prentice side of my family until I was 18. My dad was not involved in my life till I was 18. I literally met my dad the day before I graduated high school. And after a while, my dad, we would hang out and stuff. And he's like, your uncle, he manages Jerry Lawler. I'm like, ha, that's funny. This guy manages. Okay, sure. I'm like, he knows I like wrestling. He's just trying to butter me up because he's got 18 years worth of making it up to me.
Sure.
And I did a little research. I'm like, he's not lying. I'm like, this is real. This guy, he books Lawler at different places and whatnot, and they have a close relationship. And as I'm like researching all this stuff, I'm like, oh my God, like my uncle's worked in the USWA and he got to manage Bret Hart, Owen Hart. Like WWE would send guys down to face Lawler, because one of the things people don't realize is that back in the day with USWA, it was the big feud for a while was Vince McMahon against Jerry Lawler. And Vince would send down all these people like Jeff Jarrett, again, the Harts, Papa Shango, Giant Gonzalez. Like he would send all these guys down to face Lawler. They'd build up for a month and get to the big event. Lawler would go over and then they go to the next guy until finally there's the end boss with Vince managing this guy, you know, at the big event in Memphis. And then Lawler, you know, McMahon manages the guy, Lawler beats the guy, and Vince goes home upset. But when Lawler's on WWF television, Lawler's the heel at that point, going against Bret and all that. And it's like, it's just weird because when people watch the old footage, which they can do on YouTube, this is the actual beginning of Mr. McMahon. People think Austin and Vince is what created that character. It's actually the USWA that did that. But getting back on track here, I just love that side note. It's people don't know that. People don't know some of that history with the USWA. But my uncle worked with Jerry, worked with all these people, and I just finally, after a while, I said, I want to work for him. He had a territory down in Tennessee. He worked in Jackson primarily and just would go. I mean, he did 4 shows a week at one point, which is crazy. And it wasn't just, you know, 4 shows in 1 week and then he goes, takes a month off. It's weekly shows happening 4 mm-hmm. times a week. You know, guys were, it was kind of old school promoting. Guys lived off of wrestling and not a shoot job. You know, like it was insane what he was able to do with the product. And they had their weekly TV show. Lawler would come in and all this stuff. And when I came down for the first time, I was telling him all these things. I'm like, do you guys have like anything online where you post shows? And he's like, no. And so that's when I said the YouTube thing. He's like, what's a YouTube? So I explained all that out. I said, do you have a Facebook? Yeah, but I really don't know how to use that book face thing. So I explained Facebook and I said, do you know what Twitter is? And it's the same. He's in his late 50s at this point. It doesn't, you know, he's like, hey, it doesn't intrigue me to want to get into social media. Can you handle these things? And I did. And with the page on YouTube, when he passed away here in 2021, you know, there was obviously this void. We had a lot of people subscribed that wanted content. And I said, you know, let's make this the Prentice Wrestling Network. I know plenty of people who want to get their shows out to a bigger audience. Well, we got 3,000 plus people who subscribe, they'll watch it, and the views aren't just 3,000 people, you know. Just depends on how you promote it and whatnot. We had different people like Herb Simmons with his promotion out of St. Louis. We had his shows on there for a while. PWX, Niles Plunk, his promotion. We had different little random things from there. But right now, it's just mostly us. Like, it's mostly Absolute Pro Wrestling. And this year, we're really going to dive into our content, our shows, primarily being on that network.
That's awesome. Yeah. So if you're just turning in, you're listening and watching Card Subject to Change. We are here with Jason Prentice, Brandon the Shanks Eubanks, the owners of Absolute Pro Wrestling. And what I want to know, how did you two come together and how did Absolute Pro Wrestling come into being?
You want me to tell that one, Shanky boy?
Yeah, because I'll swear a lot.
It's great. Oh, yeah. So I will put it as bluntly as this. I was almost entirely done as a wrestling manager in 2019, late 2019, early 2020. I was very just depressed with wrestling. I was not happy with where I was going in life and in wrestling. And Mike Malice, Mike Morgan, big, if you've never seen this guy work, he's awesome. He's an amazing dude.
Shout out Madhouse Wrestling real quick.
Yep, shout out to those guys. Malice hits me up. He goes, hey, there's 2 really big dudes who could use you. Even if it's not in this promotion, maybe you do it elsewhere. Maybe you try and just tinker with it. But these 2, they're good, but they could be really good with you. And so I'm like, okay. And what's funny is I was on a show with Impact Pro Wrestling. I saw him and Badger Calhoun together. I said, damn, they would make a really good tag team. And the two guys that Mike Malice had told me about were exactly those two guys. It was Shank and it was Patrick Calhoun. And so I said, all right. And I was working with Rugged Pro Wrestling, Austin Fouts, his promotion. And I said, Austin, I got two guys. I know you want to put me with two people. He's like, hey, here's the booker says, we're going to give you these two guys. And I said, that's cool. I don't want them. I want these two guys. The guy who's telling me what he wants for his promotion, I'm telling him no, because I guess I have some say. And he's like, what the hell? And I said, just trust me. Just these two. I want these two. And he met them. He liked them. We did some
photos. I didn't like together. Me, but
he still don't like you.
He calls me, but he doesn't like me. That's a fact.
He doesn't like you. But we did photos and stuff together and looked great. And the whole time, this is my favorite part of the story that Shank he pops for. So I'm looking at these two guys because I'm like, I'm at this point, I'm 26, 27. I'm like, God.
You're 26.
These two guys, they're young bucks. I'm going to teach them all the things I learned along the way. I've always wanted to work with younger talents and help them progress. And like Shank's calling me. Shank's calling me, sir.
I've never kissed more butt in my life, dude. Oh, yeah. Me and him, we're like, yeah, what do you need from us, my friend?
Whatever you need, sir. Whatever you need. And he's doing that. And then finally we have this lunch date. Because we're about to bring in another guy, and we all want to just get together and pitch ideas and stuff about how we can get better. And the guy that we were with, his name's Aaron Von Baron. Aaron's sitting there, and he's like, so, Shank, like, how old are you? And Shank goes, oh, I'm 27. And I said, you're older than me? And it went from, yes, sir, whatever you need to, bitch, I'm the superior.
It has literally been this relationship. I was like, shut the hell up. You ain't even gonna talk anymore.
He's like, let the grown-ups in the room talk, okay, Prentice? Like, let's we got this.
How many years you got in wrestling? Eight? I don't care. Yeah,
that's great. You have 11 years on the business. I have 2 years, but I have age. I have age over you, and that's all that matters now. And as soon as he heard that, it went from holding the door open to you got it, you can do it. You're grown, not as grown as I am, but we just like we had this bond right away. We got along so well, and whether it was in like doing wrestling stuff or hitting each other up, playing video games, and we're just talking every single day, we had a bond in and out of the business. And when you have that. There's people, I have always said this, there's people in the business that are your friends and they're your coworkers. And Shank is more than obviously both of those things. He's like my baby brother, but he's older than me. You know, like he'll say I'm the more adult of us. Not in public though. Not in public.
Well, we have a great dude. It's a great dynamic though, because it's like he handles all the business stuff. But when it's time for somebody to get street and gangster, it's great how he just goes.
If I didn't know any better, I think you guys were a comedy routine as well.
Oh no, yeah. No! It is seriously. You come to a pre-show meeting. It is. Oh, yeah. It's nothing but dick and fart jokes.
Did you hear that, Nick? They invited us to a pre-show meeting.
Let's go.
I'm all in. I'm all in. I want
to don't listen to who's winning.
I will. You know, like. After all this, though, like we went through all these things, and he always kept poking and prodding. He's like, we need to do a wrestling show. We need to do a promotion. I'm like, I don't know, because I think the side of that people don't really understand is people want to run wrestling shows, but it's not just book the talent, book the building, get a ring, go. It is so much more, especially here in Iowa, when there's a commission and you have to do things. Super by the book, and it's not just a commission. Now it's also insurance stuff. Like there's so much, like there's so many layers to it. And we knock on wood, have done really good at that. And he kept poking, like we gotta do a show. And what flipped for me was the passing of my uncle. And we did a show down in Tennessee, this memorial show. I helped run it with my Aunt Marilyn. And it was like, I don't even think a month later after we ran that show, I said, Shank, like let's roll. Like, what do we need to do? And he gets all giddy. He gets all excited because he finally, like, he
it's also, it's, time out. It's also 3 a.m. and we're playing Call of Duty.
Yeah, seriously, that was our every day. Like, that was our every day for basically that point on to the first show we did. We're up playing COD. We're up playing whatever and just staying on the PlayStation chat, just talking, okay, who should we book? What should we do? You know, and then we're talking not just, like, maybe it's a one-and-done show, because that's the other side of it. Like, there's so many just things people don't, like I said, they don't think about when it comes to a show. If you're getting into the wrestling business to try and make money, you're in the wrong business.
Wrong.
But also, you can make money if you do things the right way.
Thank you, your favorite saying, if done right.
If done right, you can make, he hates when I say it, but
it's his way out of everything. It's his way out of all my ideas.
Absolutely. It is. At this point, it is one of my catchphrases. It's one
Everybody's
got to
have a catchphrase, right?
He'll be like, I don't think we can do this matchup because it's physically impossible to have a match on the moon. And I'll be like, yeah, but if you do it right.
If you promote it, it's done right.
And we can do all this. And I explain. He goes, I hate it because you explained it and now it works and I don't like it. I hate it, Prentice. But there's times where people run a show and it's one and done and it's over. And I said, let's just get through one. If we like it, if we enjoy it, if there's a good reaction, a good turnout, there's so many variables. If we feel like we could keep doing it, we could do it. We lost money at first.
Yeah, that's right. Our first show, we literally had 125 people. We lost a lot of money, and me and him were just giddy as shit. We're like, dude, we did it. Are we doing another one? He goes,
yeah.
It's going to cost us a lot of money. And then we fast forward 1 year. I'm threatening his life. I'm dude, hey, listen, if this stuff don't start turning, I'm going to shoot you, and it's over. And then from that point on, it's been pretty good cake.
And we had, again, last year, like the previous years, we've been in business for 2 years, but it was our best year for so many reasons. It's not just a financial thing. It's not just content-wise. It's just so many facets of it. And that first show, we lost money, and we're just like, you know what? We probably would have lost that on a bet this weekend. Okay, learn. How do we fix this? What do we do to better everything? And
I think what it was is just that the city of Waterloo needed a wrestling product what it was. Needed some sort of energy. We're still like the only entertainment. Like, they just started bringing fights back. It's crazy.
Hold that thought about the city of Waterloo and being the only show in town. Hold that thought right now. We're going to take a quick break here on the card subject to change. When we come back, we're going to talk everything Absolute Pro Wrestling. We're going to find out what it's like to go to an Absolute Pro show, what people can expect, what the fan experience is like. We're going to get right back to that, but hold on. We got to pay some sponsors here real quick. We'll be right back on the Card Subject to Change podcast.
For Frequency's Sake has you covered on all things sports. From the squared circle to the hardwood and the gridiron to the speedway, we've got something for everyone. Walk down the aisle with the boys from Card Subject to Change every Sunday as they take a deep dive into everything pro wrestling. Need your gambling fix? We've got you there. Enter Pit Row with Rod Villagomez and Fast Money as we win the checkered flag with NASCAR, Xfinity, and truck race winners and props. Football more your style? Explore the waters of NFL DFS with DFS Deep Dive with Brian Craighead and Jordan Kernan each week. More into the science portion of the game? We've got a double dose of action there. The Professor John Bush and Dennis Michelson take you into their science lab and dissect your week in the data lab. Want an analytical take? Nick Girl and the team at Gridiron AI come to you each week with The Lab. Need to know who to start last minute? The network's flagship show, For Fantasy's Sake, is here in a pinch. The fellows come to you live every football Sunday from 10 to 11:30 Central with the week's best DFS, gambling, and lineup advice. And wrap up your Sundays with Joe Winkle and Nick Brinks as they come to you live with educated ignorance looking at all the day's action. Can't get enough of Joe? He comes to you three times a week. Not enough football on Sunday? Not a problem. Kick your feet up at lunch on Monday and slip on into the football lounge with Mark and Dan while they look at the week that was in news, notes, and more. For Frequency's Sake, you know what we mean.
Durham Remodeling has been serving the Quad Cities area since 1973. With over 50 years of excellence on their track record, You'll see why it's so easy to trust their experts when it comes to all of your home improvement projects. Durham Remodeling's work is 100% guaranteed, so you can rest assured that you're getting the best service around. Call 309-786-6715 for all of your roofing, siding, flooring, windows, and painting needs. That's Durham Remodeling, 309-786-6715.
My name's Ryan Allison. I've spent over a decade immersed in the art of tattooing. Sharply honing my skills has materialized into a diverse and prestigious body of work. Each tattoo reflects my relentless pursuit of excellence, and every client I work with is a living embodiment of that unwavering commitment. I will gladly and wholeheartedly embrace your distinct vision.
Are you looking for the largest slice in the Quad Cities? The right spot is Lopie's Pizza. It's better than a hot dog and a handshake. They have two great locations, uptown on Brady for your delivery and catering needs, and downtown at 429 East 3rd Street in Davenport for the full experience. Lopie's is family-owned and family-friendly. Into wrestling like us, you can catch shows every day and twice on Sunday at their downtown location. Who knows, you may run into a local wrestler or a local podcaster or two while you're there. Stop by each month for a different featured slice by various artists. Lopie's Pizza, a proud sponsor of the Card Subject to Change podcast on the For Frequency Sake podcast network.
Hello, this is Mick Foley, and you are listening to the Card Subject to Change podcast.
Welcome back to the show, everybody. You are tuned into Card Subject to Change. We are powered by Lopie's Pizza and built by Durham Remodeling. Before we get back into the meat and potatoes of talking with Jason Prentice and Brandon Eubanks, want to take just another second to talk about our great sponsor, Lopie's. If you haven't been down there, now is the absolute perfect time, no pun intended, since we're talking with the guys from Absolute Pro Wrestling. They have the SCW Slam and Slice down there, and if you haven't tried it, you only have a little bit more. The end of January, that is going away. Get down there and give it a try. It is magnificent. Chicken, bacon, spinach, and a barbecue peach drizzle that is just fantastic. But we are here with the owners of Absolute Pro Wrestling. And I want to know, you know, we've been talking about how you guys came together, how you got in the business. Let's focus more on your promotion. What is it like to be part of Absolute Pro? Talk about the Absolute Pro Wrestling experience, both for you guys as the owners and from what you see from the fans' perspective as they come into the show.
Rock, paper, scissors, shoot, I guess.
I could have directed that at one of you.
Well, I think it's unique. I think it's unique, really, because you get two perspectives from Shank and I. Shank can kind of tell you the perspective as a talent, because like he says, I'll deal a lot with the business stuff. He does deal with a lot with talent stuff. You know, at first we always joked because some talents would come to me about a question about the show and he'd be like, they never message me. And then eventually they started messaging him. He goes, oh, hey, by the way, so-and-so hit me up on Tuesday. And I said, they didn't message me. He goes, I know, second fiddle doesn't feel so good now, does it? You know, like he'll just give me grief about it. But like, we do have two very different perspectives, which is great, because then we can kind of come together. If there's something that I see on, you know, the stuff I'm seeing, and if there's something he's seeing on the side he's dealing with, we can kind of work together. And that's why I think we cover so much ground as a unit together. That's why we work so well with Absolute Pro Wrestling. But I think as far as what fans get, I think we're unique to any area we go to. You know, my hometown's Algona, Iowa. When we were on a show here in Algona, it is much different as far as aesthetics, as far as even ticket pricing. It's just different top to bottom when we run here, because there's not a lot happening. And I know Shanks talked about that with Waterloo too. There's not a lot happening in Kossuth County, where we are based out of. There's bowling 45 minutes to an hour away, and that's it. Like, if you want to do something on a Saturday night, there's really nothing. The biggest thing that happens in Algona is probably our fair. So once a year we get to go and do something, hoopla, and okay, cool, and then it's done. And so for us, it's really exciting because we started doing shows here at Algona, and it went from, all right, we did two to, you know, we'll increase this to like four or five. And I think this year we're looking at like six or seven shows. And that's the same with Waterloo. We only did four Waterloo shows the first year. And Shank goes, I want us to do so many more. And not just even like shows in Waterloo. He's like, man, if we can get like 10 shows in 2023, that'd be cool. I said, Shank, that's dumb. It's horrible. We're not doing it. So we did 15 last year. Like we did like we just sat there, like we're expanding Fort Dodge. We're expanding Waterloo. We're going to expand in Algona. And each of those communities, they're very different. The crowds are very different. Yes, we pull some people. It's crazy, guys. There are people who will go to a Waterloo show and say, man, when's your next show? And they'll say, oh, it's such and such date in Algona or Fort Dodge. And they show up to those shows. And there's people who do the same with Algona. They'll go to the Fort Dodge and Waterloo. And the same with Fort Dodge. They'll go to Waterloo and Algona. And Shank's like, weren't they just at the show? And so, yeah, there's people who want to follow the product. And that just tells you the work, yes, that we do, but also the people in the ring performing, busting their asses for us. It tells you their body of work, that there are people who will literally follow us from town to town, which is awesome to see. And there's regulars, you know, maybe not at every show, like they don't travel to all three, but there's regulars that are at almost every show that we're based out of for Waterloo. You know, there's one guy, this is a true story. My mom told me about this at first. I said, no way. She goes, yeah, this guy's going to bring a bus to the next show, he said. He's going to have this traveling bus with him and his family and his friends. And I said, no way. And we hear, and Shank goes, yeah, Magic School Bus is outside. And there's like 40 people coming out of a bus. This guy brought his grandkids, wow, his daughter, all these people, all friends and family from a neighboring town, brought them into Waterloo just to watch our show. And they reserve seats every show now.
It's got to be a reassuring thing be a part of something like this. And you've got people traveling multiple hours to come watch your program and come watch your show. I think one thing you'll notice about wrestling fans is loyalty. When they get onto something, they're loyal to it, and they're going to follow you wherever that show goes. And that's got to be reassuring to you guys, reaffirming you guys, got to make you guys feel great.
Yeah. You know,
what I was going to say, the one thing I think that it is with our show is like, because like I said, I live in Waterloo. I work in the public. And a lot of the fans come to where I work. You know, so I see them, they talk to me, they tell me stuff. And what I think they like about our, is like one thing we got told, which is, it is very true. Indie wrestling, you cannot really do storylines. There's nothing to it. Cause how, you know, you're not running a regular schedule, but for some reason we do storylines, and I don't care what anybody else says. I think we do them right. We don't run monthly. Like I would love us to in these locations. However, we run once, maybe like we get the closest we'll get is 3 weeks at the same location for a show. So like we ran Waterloo, and then we ran Waterloo where you guys came. We ran a show 3 weeks before that in Waterloo. So Mike was saying Jason was saying he was a little nervous. How close can you get it before people are like, maybe I'll catch the next one or I'll catch. We didn't have that. I think we had a better turnout even. I don't know. I just, like I said, like he was going on. I think it's the wrestlers giving the effort too. Cause you see some guys who go out there and they just half do it. They don't want to, they don't like it. They're not there. I don't think we really have that problem. I think everybody loves to come and fire for, and Waterloo's just a hot crowd anyway. That's a great place to go do so.
Yeah. I mean, the last Waterloo show we did, the energy felt different, you know, everything top to bottom. The performers, we're high fiving and we're celebrating. Because we just had one of the most kick-ass shows we'd ever done. Everybody that took tickets for us, everybody that helped people get to their seating, everybody who did sound, everybody who did ring setup and everything, everybody just freaking nailed it that whole night, top to bottom. And we were super happy as a team. And like I told Shank, I did say, I'm like, how close do we get? You know, but there was some proof in the pudding. Where we had the same thing happen in Fort Dodge. We didn't have a great turnout at a show in September. I'm like, well, we got one more to go in October. I said, man, I hope, you know, the tickets, the pre-sales go well. We had a lot of people that did pre-sale on it. And the next show we did in Fort Dodge, you know, 3 weeks later, everybody who got a ticket on pre-sale showed up to collect. And then we drew even more people in Waterloo. I'm like, you know what? I worried less with Waterloo after that, because I'm like, you know what? We got a really good fan base. And we're moving to a new location. And it's downtown. Maybe we'll draw more people. And everything just, it went according to what we were hoping for. You know, we got more people, people who pre-bought tickets. They showed up, and Shank's now just hoping that we go monthly instead of, you know, on, you know, hey, go 2 months, then we do a show, wait a couple months.
It's not even that. I don't care. I just want to run Waterloo till it dies, baby.
Well, he also just wants to wrestle every weekend, and I told him, I said, I don't blame him. Because we haven't had a show now since November. Our next one's February. And I'm like, you know, we could put together a show if you wanted to next weekend. Like, you know, like, if you want to. Because we both have the edge right now.
If done right, correct?
Yeah,
you get it.
Dude, you're invited to the end of the year dinner that I never go to.
Right.
Nice, I swear to God, I'm 0-2. I'm 0-2 on end of the year dinners. I've not made one of them.
Not one of them.
Hey, ask him if we go to app.
And it's his idea.
It was my idea. I didn't go to it.
He's like, we should go.
After the show, where are we all going out to eat? Where are we going out to eat? It doesn't matter. You're not going to be there. Yeah,
No. Yeah, I'll be there. Don't worry about it. Well, I'll meet you in 10 minutes. Never show.
Yeah.
Never show.
They call me 25 minutes later on video chat. Where are you at? I'm in my bathroom. home.
So I want to talk about that last Waterloo show. You guys had a bit of a celebrity in your midst, if I'm not mistaken. Talk about the mayor of Waterloo coming out to your show.
That was awesome. That was a huge, I feel like a huge moment for us. It doesn't matter how you feel politically about things. The city of Waterloo just being, I guess, taking us in a lot after this show. Like, we talked with Mayor Quentin Hart after, and even during the show. Like, we had a really good conversation with him. And he's asking, like, what are your plans for next year? Do you guys love this area? Why'd you bring the show here? And, you know, like Shank was telling him, he's like, we wanted to just bring entertainment, cheap entertainment, but it's not cheap entertainment. It's not cheap, and it's not low grade. Like, it's
– you're getting your bang for your buck.
Yeah, you know, you're bringing a family to a show where there's some people who will charge you $50 a head for these – for these whole, like, you got five people in your group, they're charging you $50 a head, and they're just, you know, they're not, they're good, but they're not great. I feel, and Shank will say it the same thing, I feel like we got a great group of talent, great group of men and women who come in, they commit, they are fully invested in what we are doing. They want to get better, but they want to make the team better. And that creates a really good product for families and those that are diehard wrestling fans, period. For everybody of all walks of life to really enjoy. And when Quentin Hart was there, the mayor of Waterloo, he's like, okay, after the show is done, he's like, you're going to get a hold of us. We're going to help you guys. We're going to do all these things to really push you guys and help promote your show, because you guys bring something very good to our area. And like Shank said, there's not a lot else happening with the city of Waterloo for events, and they want this to be successful. It's a big building. You guys, you know, you've seen it there, CZ. Like, that's an area that the city owns too. That's that, you know, Cedar Valley Sportsplex. They own it. And so they want that to do well. They want the building to do well, but they want us to do well. And it's something that we're really looking forward to this year. This is a big year for us in Waterloo.
The slogan's perfect, man. For the bird.
Yeah.
And I'm not ashamed to admit, I went up to Waterloo. One, I love going to new shows. I used to have a job where I was traveling around the country, tried to catch as many independent shows as I could. But I was going up to Waterloo specifically to see your show and to follow good friend of the podcast, JT Energy, who was wrestling up there. And yeah, that it's great. I got to see him. I always love seeing him wrestling, but bottom of the card to the top, your talent does not disappoint. I'm going to throw that out there. You guys have a lot of great names. I'll throw Ethan Everhart out there. He's your champion, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Yep.
He enjoyed seeing him. I'm not always good with names in first meetings, so drawing a few more names out of my brain is going to be hard. But top to bottom, you guys have a great roster. You've got a great product, and I encourage anybody who is listening here in the Quad Cities, next time you guys have a show in Waterloo, make the 2-hour drive. It's worth it. You're going to get your money's worth at this show. Which I'll ask when, I know you've got a couple of shows coming up. Talk about when your next shows are, where we can find you guys, for anyone in Iowa who's listening.
So with our schedule coming up, we got February 24th. We're back here in Algona. That's going to be a really fun show. We got people that are returning, debuting in Algona, and we also get to debut, knock on wood. We're going to test everything out. We got kind of a new setup for our shows, which we're really excited about. In this offseason, we've been working on a lot of things because we've always wanted to grow with everything we do. And that goes from not just what's on our YouTube channel, not just what they're seeing in the ring, but also what's around them. We want the atmosphere to go and grow. And so we're going to try something new in Algona, which is going to be a lot of fun, knock on wood. And for sure, people will see that at Waterloo. You know, that's, like I said, we're testing a lot of things out early on to make sure that by the time we get to the next Waterloo show, everything's going to go for everybody to enjoy. But February 24th, we're in Algona. March 15th, a Friday, in Fort Dodge. We're going to have that St. Patrick's weekend. So a good way to start off the weekend is to go and hang out with everybody at the wrestling show and then
Sure. Go
party up. They got some pubs. They got Old Boston in downtown Fort Dodge. And go check that out afterwards. So, you know, they can do that. And then March 23rd. March 23rd is a big date for us. It's our first show back in Waterloo. There's so many things that we have put together for this. Shank came up with the whole concept. We just randomly, we were like, oh, hey, we had people who got sick at a Fort Dodge show last year. And so we're like, oh, well, let's add a battle royal. We'll add a battle royal into this, to spread the card up. We'll get another match out of a battle royal. And Shank was in charge of it. And Shank did it in a way like I've never even touched it. I've never even thought of. It's just super simple. And it's a very easy concept. And then I said, do you want, like, we should do more of this. And he's like, I got an idea. And so we came up with this Winter Brawl Classic, which is just, it's the Rumble. It's as clear as day, it's the Rumble. But it's never really been done on the level of which we're doing it at. And we're really, at least we don't think so. I don't know. Maybe there's people that do it. They probably are people that do it. But for us, it's new. It's fresh for our audience, fresh for our product. And we're really excited about doing that, where it's the first TV of USA Wrestling. You know, Absolute Pro Wrestling presents USA Wrestling. And we have all these matches. Ethan Everhart defending against Alvin Falcone, which is big. Alvin's been growing with us in Absolute Pro Wrestling. He's somebody that everybody loves seeing. We have Matty Starr, Jackson King, Leo Santel in a six-man match after their big, you know, attack on Ethan Everhart. The boys are in action as well. They'll be in that Winter Brawl Classics, what we're calling it. And Bryce Jordan will be in action. We got another guy debuting. Like, that's the thing. We got all these new, fresh faces. It really is the kickoff of a big year for us in Waterloo.
That's March 23rd.
Excuse me.
March 23rd.
The big return show to Waterloo. And that, you said that'll be the first show that you guys are going to put on the YouTube page as well, correct?
Yep. Yep. Okay. That'll be the first one where we'll break it down. Shank's, oh man, Shank's like, we're doing full shows. He's like, we're figuring out the dynamic of it. Cause I said, oh, it's easy. Just do two matches per episode. He goes, I want them all out now. Cause all the talent, they love seeing, they love seeing that full show. So they don't have to wait a little bit. Cause him and I are both very impatient. We're very like, I want it now. People,
no, which, no, you're way, way more impatient than I am.
This dude has posters
made for 2025.
That's the other thing. Like we started doing in-house posters, and which is great because I've been learning all these things. And I'll send him a poster, And then he'll be like, oh, that looks good. I said, I already changed 5 things on it already. What do you think? Yeah, no, that's good. I said, cool. This is the new poster. I just finalized. It's done. Like, everything. He's like, I just start sending him everything I can.
Oh, yeah. I got Victor Payne versus Cole Cannon. The rematch of the rematches, baby.
Yeah, March 23rd.
Well, gentlemen, I think you guys have been fantastic. I love that we got to talk all about Absolute Pro, learn how you guys got in the business. And before we kind of wrap things up, where can people find you on social media? Other than obviously you've got the YouTube page, but where else, where can we find Absolute Pro and follow along on socials?
You go ahead, Shane.
Oh, that Absolute Pro Wrestling on Facebook. I don't think we have a Twitter, do we?
We do have Twitter, Pro.
I don't have any social media. That's my problem.
The only social media he has is the Absolute Pro Wrestling page.
That's literally it. I don't have social media, so.
I said, don't worry, I'll handle the Twitter, which we don't do a lot of on Twitter, but it's @ProAbsolute on Twitter. And no Instagram, although Kyle Lenskow, shout out Kyle Lenskow, the best.
Shout out to the real MVP, Kyle, the guy who's behind the scenes out here just wrecking it as a manager of life.
Kyle is one of two people who's been to every APW show, and it's me and Kyle. Kyle and I, we're the only ones who have been to
every. I thought Bryce Jordan has been to everyone.
He, you know what? Yeah, it is three. It'd be three then, yeah.
Yeah, because I'm the only one who has, and I felt I didn't go to one show.
Nope.
So just wasn't feeling it.
Just wasn't feeling it. He's like, you see, this doesn't work for me. But I will say, by the way, I did appreciate the title of this episode where it's the pros of Absolute Pro. I did appreciate that it wasn't the cons of Absolute Pro, because Tony and Nick are busy, so they're doing stuff for their own promotions. So, you know, there's no cons here.
that'll be the next time you guys are on.
That's right.
Sure. We'll get bought out by Big Nick.
Oh man.
It'd be my finally I got signed. WCW should have called me back, nerd. There's this huge running joke with me and WCW. I did it in the middle of a match one time with a phone. Somebody had a phone and they handed it to me. It was Cole Cannon. I was like, "Hello?" I was like, "What do you mean WCW ain't calling me back?" What? Hello? And I turn and he hits me with the phone. So yeah, now I have this running joke with WCW ain't calling me back and I still don't get it.
Still waiting.
Hey, I ain't going until they quit recruiting, I ain't gonna quit wrestling, all right?
Well, I want to look a little bit ahead to our future while you guys are here. You have helped us. We're going to have Maddie Starr, one of your big talents, on the show in February.
Absolutely, so really hate that guy.
Excited about that. You know, I get the impression that he's not very favorable with the fans
or people.
The last show that
just people.
He got his own locker room, not because we wanted to give him it. He's literally that bad of a person.
We'll ask him about that for sure.
Definitely on the list. But I want to thank you, gentlemen. You have been fantastic. Definitely look forward to you guys coming back on the show in the future. Anytime you want to hype up your events. But speaking of the future, Nick, we got to talk about our next big future. And I got to ask you before we wrap things up officially, did you remember to set the right counter? Are we going to tick over to 3 digits, or is it going to be a Y2K thing where everything shuts down next week?
It might be a Y2K thing. Everything goes to zeros next week. Episode 100 next week, and we're gonna hit you.
It goes to zeros. There's a fireworks. The lights are on. What the heck's on? All of a sudden, it's like the jacket lights up. You're like, no.
And then you see this.
You can always pull the Mortal Kombat, like the video game. They're back to Mortal Kombat 1 now, which confuses everybody.
I saw that.
You'll be like, "Yeah, welcome to episode 1 of Card Subject to Change," and everyone's like, "Wait a second,
0-0." Yeah, next week.
1.01. 1.02. And then when you get to episode 199, you call it you just call it Travis Pastrana. That's it. 199. Travis Pastrana.
199. We're hitting you with two episodes next week. We're going to preview the Royal Rumble live from Kavanaugh's on their patio, their heated patio, might I add.
Woo! So
be able to be in there for that. We'll watch the Rumble together as a watch party. They've got a kitchen there. You can order what you want for food. I think I'm going for a big burger basket, maybe some chicken wings. I don't know. But after the Rumble, we'll break down the Rumble and kick off officially the road to WrestleMania. We're doing that all next week with episode 100. We're going to hit you with two episodes. And CZ, I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be a great time.
Oh, I'm super excited. You never know who's going to show up. So, hell, Sting. If you guys want to come into Davenport, if Sting shows up, I don't know what I.
Oh, well, first Sting of all, shows I know up, what I'll I do. I will melt in a puddle on the spot. I'll do. It's Sting. Yep. Yeah,
I really enjoyed this podcast, guys. You definitely got a fan now. I'm definitely going to be watching from here on out.
We enjoyed having you guys. You guys were great. You guys made this one of the easiest ones we've ever done. I mean, this podcast is fun if done right. So that's
I'm gonna blade one of these times, dude. One of these times, I'm just gonna gig. Oh. He's just gonna say it. And I'm just gonna go. Forget it. I'm cutting my face off, pulling it down.
The shake's been busted open, and he's not even in a match.
I'm just like, what's going on? Ow! They're attacking myself. No.
If every show could be like this, I haven't laughed this much, I don't think, on an episode. So, and that's good.
Hey, every podcast I'm on, I get this reaction.
It's because you haven't been doing it right. That's why.
You learned. I hate this so much. I hate all of this. If done right. Oh, God.
It's our new podcast. Check it out.
If done right, it's our new podcast. And yeah. It's after every show we do, we just talk about all the crap we should have done because that was terrible.
Exactly. The show could have been done better if we would have done this. If done right, sponsored.
You know what? If I probably didn't show up, it would have been a way better show.
No, not at all.
How's Fatal 4-Way going?
Oh my God, dude! Well, Kane just showed up with a casket. I'm weird that you asked. There's a 4-way going on, and now there's a Kane with a casket.
I looked up. I looked up the card during the break, and I'm like, "Oh man, he is."
I've been like periodically looking over like this. I'm like, "Why is this going?" Dude, I watched CM Punk hit Big Show, and Glo goes. And then Big Show punches him and he falls. I'm like, what is going on here? This is probably when Punk's hurt and he doesn't like himself. Oh, Punk's going for a casket ride. Yep, there he goes. Goodbye, Punk. Rest in peace. No?
For our guest, Jason Prentice, Brandon the Shank Eubanks, I want to thank you guys for joining us once again. For the Wizard CZ, I am your host, Never Wrong, Nick Bull. This has been the podcast by the fan, for the fan, card subject to change. We are powered by Lopez Pizza. We are built by Durham Remodeling. And we can't wait to see you next week for episode 100 of Kavanaugh's Live. Take care. Thank you for tuning in. God bless y'all.